If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump.
Hey,
listen. Oh, Kermie!
Before you tell everybody what goes down in this episode, I have to share something that I didn't realize that you can do now on iTunes. This used to drive me crazy when I had a specific episode that I wanted to share with someone that I wanted them to listen to. I used to send it, and then it would just send the link of Mind Pump, and then they got 500 episodes they'd have to try and figure out. Mm. Now they have updated that on the podcast, the iTunes app, so when you're listening to an episode and you find an episode that you really want to share...
It's probably going to be this one.
You really want to share with somebody, if you look down in the bottom left-hand corner, you'll see a little square with an arrow on it. You hit that square, and it automatically sends that exact episode either via email, via text message, however you want to send it to somebody. It's really easy now to share the episodes, which was pretty cool. I think they just updated that maybe a few months ago.
Excellent. Thank you, Adam. Nice. So for the first 30 minutes or so, we have nice conversation. We talk about being hungry in business.
Get you fired up a little bit.
Exactly. Then we did mention our sponsor Organifi in this episode. I also want to make the note here. If you enter the code MINDPUMP, you get 20% off. Then we get into Justin's chicken story.
Apocalypse.
You might not want to miss that one unless...
Unless you're PETA or...
If you're PETA, fast forward past that part.
Yeah, you're not going to want to hear that.
We talk about hunting and killing our own food. And then we get into the questions. The first question is how we mention protein cycling and cycling other supplements. So how do we recommend that we do that? Like, how often should you cycle your protein low and cycle some of your supplements? Then we answer the question of a gentleman who can't eat vegetables, literally finds them absolutely disgusting.
He sounds like my two-year-old.
So what should he do? Hint, bustle.
Bustle.
Then we get into the next question. Somebody's asking us if they should do their post-prime session after they do the sauna after the workout, or if it should be immediately after their workout. The answer to that question is not what you might expect. Mm. Or is it? Then the last question, sandbag training.
You sandbagger, you.
Again.
What do we think about sandbag training for muscle development and for fat burning? Also, this month, enroll in any of our programs. Look, if you want to get in shape, the best thing you could do is hire one of us personally. The second best thing you could do is enroll.
I'm glad you put up that point out
there. Of course.
Yeah.
Is enroll in the MAPS program. These are programs designed by us specifically. We design them for specific forms of adaptation.
Lots of specifics going on here.
That's right. Yeah.
MAPS, and to be specific.
MAPS Anabolic is our foundational program. Great for overall strength and development. Then we have MAPS Aesthetic, which is for those of you who are cosmetic focused, or if you're a stage competitor, bikini, physique, bodybuilder. We have MAPS Performance for those of you who are athletic-minded or just want functional performance, if you want to be able to move as good as you look. We also have MAPS Anywhere, which is our program that includes no equipment. So in other words, you can get that program, work out in your closet, nobody has to know.
Move as good as you look. I like that.
Then we have MAPS Prime, which teaches you how to prime your workouts, and Prime Pro, which is correctional. Or you could do the Super Bundle, which has almost all of those programs in one. If you enroll in any of them individually or in the bundle, this month you get access to our forum for free. Our private forum normally costs $87. It has 2,000 plus members, many of which are personal trainers, fitness professionals, other competitors. And of course, me, Adam, and Justin are on there every single day. It's a great way to kind of fire off ideas and get the support you need along your fitness journey. You get that for free this month if you enroll in any of those programs. Now, all you got to do to get those is go to mindpumpmedia.com and enroll.
T-shirt time.
Oh, yeah.
Give away them shirts, Doug.
Yeah, kind of a disappointing last week. Whoa. Only 6 reviews.
What? Whoa, that's like a record low.
I'm hearing some crickets.
We need to tell people how to leave reviews again.
Good idea.
So here's what you do. You go to your podcast app, go up in the search function. Even if you're already subscribed, you have to do this. Search Mind Pump, 2 words. Click on our icon. Then you'll be able to see a tab that says reviews. Leave a review. The odds of winning a free Mind Pump t-shirt are actually quite high. So you definitely want to do this.
Yeah.
It has to be 5-star, by the way.
And we're giving out two shirts. First up is Nick George 89. James Gaines 116. Both of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes at mindpumpmedia.com. Your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
I came in at 6.
What time did you come?
6.
Ooh. Oh, yeah.
6.
I but usually text him right before.
When you
that,
guys were on that call, when you finally strolled in here at like 9 or 9:30, I was meeting with our young, motivated, and I can talk about him because he doesn't listen to the show.
He's too cool.
He wanted to have a little meeting with me.
You talking about Draw?
Yeah. He wanted
our boy Draw.
Yeah.
Draw.
Draw Dizzle. He wanted to have a meeting with me to tell me how motivated he was and to tell me you know, how hard he was going to work.
Mm.
And so we had a good little meeting at breakfast. I could tell he was very nervous. But
did you tell him coffee's for closers only?
Well, you know,
give him one of those speeches.
You push it away from his vicinity.
I mean, you guys know damn well that, you know, when it comes to those type of conversations, I'm probably not the funnest person to talk to about that, right? Like, I'm not easy. I believe
a lot of times you just need a hug.
Yeah, seems like that. Yeah.
It's fun. You're fun-ish, right. But not the fun.
Well, I think
you know what I mean. So you're not fun,
like in spurts.
Well, I mean, I think for you guys, it's cool because we're all the same team. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, it's kind of like when you watch or like when you like have like Dennis Rodman on your basketball team. Like, you hate the guy when you play against him, but you want him on your team.
Oh my God, you're Dennis Rodman.
Yeah.
Oh,
man. Right. So that's
Maybe like Horace Grant.
Are you gonna wear a dress?
No.
No, I'm definitely more Dennis. Dennis Rodman was the first autobiography.
He's so flamboyant, though.
He was the first biography.
Exactly.
That, he paints his toes. Okay, like, fine. So I read that. Did you guys ever read his?
I feel like Scottie Pippen.
You
feel
you kind of are.
A little bit. I'm kind of Jordan.
So that would be Justin Jordan. So Justin's Jordan, you're Scottie Pippen, and I'm Dennis Rodman.
Pretty much in the clutch, I win championships.
I'm just kidding. I'm like Joe Montana.
No. Oh, wait. Wrong sport, asshole.
Oh, my bad. Sorry.
I'm like Larry Bird, dude.
Sorry, I forgot we were talking about golf.
Let's get it straight.
It was really cute to watch him get all flustered, but share with me his passion. He's only 18. You know, I forget that he's only 18 because he's always with us.
I love when I see like young kids like that, 18, 19, 20, who are motivated, driven, and hungry.
Well, you just see the fire finally spark.
I love it.
And it's rare, and here I know I'm going to get a bunch of people mad at me right here, but it's rare to find this in those millennials. I feel like
it's rare in just general? It's always rare,
It is rare in general. I think it's even more rare in that generation. I think that, I mean, you talked about this just the other day about the, you know, people not even getting their driver's license.
Yeah, there's
it feels like a lost art.
There's some weird statistics going on. I mean, when I was I was managing gyms. I was 19, and I didn't know anybody my age that was, you know, aggressive like that. So it's always going to be rare. But you're right. There's these weird, interesting statistics right now with kids. Like, they don't want to drive. They don't go out as much. They have less sex. They don't go to movies as much. Although that could be it's all due to technology, I think, right?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, Taylor even had to kind of talk some sense into him, because I know when we first gave him his offer and told him what he would get paid hourly, he wasn't that excited. It wasn't like and Taylor was like, what the fuck is wrong with you? You have an opportunity to be a part of something that is amazing. It's growing. It's fun as shit to be a part of. You're doing something you love.
He's like, we don't even beat him up right now just for saying that.
Right? That you're passionate about.
Just wait till this
hold him upside down.
And Taylor's like, do any of your friends make that much money? And he's like, well, I have one friend that makes that kind of money. He's like, well, what does he do? He's like, construction. Like, fuck, he does construction for, you know, 8 to 10
hard ass labor.
Right. He gets up at 5 o'clock in the morning and he's fucking carrying around 2x4s all over the place and nailing shit on.
And you get to come in here and have a good time.
Right. Yeah. He goes, and so he's like, and do something you're passionate about and that you love. And then with the potential that it could grow into something that could turn into possibly your career. Wake the fuck up, you know? And so he kind of had that.
I like Taylor.
Right. He kind of had that conversation with him. And he admitted this. He admitted that this part of this, it was his own like struggle, this inner struggle that he had. And then he kind of asked me like, you know, I just want to feel confident that I have the position. I said, dude, that was what the first conversation was. You have the position. But I said, let me tell you something, you know, and you work your ass off. We have the hours for you to put that work in. But I will tell you this. you know, we will sit down at this exact same fucking counter and I will evaluate your work and tell you if it's contributing to the business, because you can make all the cool fucking videos you want. If it's not driving more revenue to the business, I don't give a shit about it. And that's hard for someone to hear who has art that's into what you're like, loves what they're doing, they're passionate about.
It's just called reality.
It is reality.
I mean, yeah.
And I'm like, if you can't show me that you're not adding value, and by adding value, I mean fucking money to the business, you're not worth that position to me. I'd much rather contract that overseas, maybe somebody who's less talented that I don't really like, that I don't care about, that I'm paying $8 an hour over there just to get the shit done, because what we've proven to do already is working. And if you can't find a way to make it work better, then, you know, it might be a short-lived position for
you. There's two directions he could go with this. Because I'm imagining myself at his age, right? And if I hear that, all that does is give me a boner. It just gets me really psyched.
Well, that's what I'm looking
like,
for.
Like,
right?
Fuck yeah. Like, what?
I'm looking to separate that, right? I'm looking to separate that right there. Yeah. Is I'm looking to see, like, that type of push either pushes someone like you to the next level, or it scares the fuck out of somebody who's weak.
Pushes you to push.
I was in that position. I gave Mark Masteroff, who was the founder of 24 Fitness, a tour of the gym as a 18 or 19 year old kid. I didn't know that.
You didn't tell me that.
Oh yeah. So he came in to my club.
Was he just happened to be touring that day when you were there?
So he was with John, who was the VP at the time.
Right, I remember.
And he came around and John was taking him to his clubs and he says, I want you to meet this kid. Because at the time I was doing numbers nobody had ever seen before. So
you've been there for a little bit. How long?
I was an AGM. Maybe only a few months.
Okay.
Or a couple months.
So you're still green.
But I was blowing out. I mean, I was, like I said, I was hitting 40, 50,000 in commissionable revenue. And, you know, before that, the records were set at like 27, you know, 25. So nobody ever seen that before. So he walks in. And he's like, and everybody's like, oh, Masteroff's here. Everybody's freaking out, right? Because he's the founder. And then they come up and they're like, hey, he wants you to give him a tour. He wants to see what you're doing because he wants to know why you're doing so well. So I'm like, fuck yeah. So I literally, I remember like it was yesterday when they told me that, like the hair stood up on its end, but not because I was nervous.
You're excited.
Like I was like a dog looking to like fight, like, let's do this. So I took him on a tour. Mm. I did my whole thing, which back then nobody had done before, but I was selling fitness before the membership. I was selling personal training. I was selling results and all that stuff. And I came up and I sat down with him, did the whole presentation. He gave me a couple objections, you know, to try and see how I would overcome them. I overcame them. And he goes, if everybody did what you did, he goes, we would be three times the company in terms of revenue. So I said, that's awesome. I said, when are you going to make me a manager? And he said, oh, you know, you got some time. You know, it's going to take some time. You're young, this and that. I said, I am outperforming everybody that you have. I want that opportunity. And he said, you'll get it. He said, just be patient. I said, okay. I said, I'm gonna make it so ridiculously obvious that you need to promote me that you'll be embarrassed not to. I mean, those are the words that I said to a great man, and he left, and that's what I ended up doing. But, you know, like you're talking about with withdraw, like that's a situation that sometimes you're in life where you're shown an opportunity, like either you sink or you crush. And most people decide to sink because it's scary. Mm-hmm. But every once in a while, you get those people who are like ready to destroy. And
it's kind of like the fallback for, you know, like you get into a real pressure situation like that. And it's real easy to pull back. Really easy to pull back. It's a totally different operating system when you decide to face and mm-hmm. you decide to perform and do it on command.
Fuck yeah, it's uncomfortable.
Very uncomfortable.
But it's exciting.
But you're right, dude. The hairs on the back of your neck stand up. You know, you just you get into this zone and your eyes get focused, you know, everything tenses up. Like I was in that same experience not too long ago. So
oh, it's great, isn't it?
I felt like I was back in the arena.
You're alive.
You know in the arena. Damn it. I love that shit.
You learn to seek that as you get older. When you're younger, you tend to avoid it, right? You avoid, and I think that's what, you know, the slight millennial jab I just had was I think that is a lot of what it is I think right now at a young age, they still are trying to avoid those situations. I think most of them, and when I say them, I'm not talking about people listening to this podcast, because it's already been shown that if you're a podcast listener, you're already above the average person, right? As far as
scientific studies have shown,
That where you're a smarter.
This is all the fault of the helicopter parents. Boom! I said it.
Yeah.
Hey, let your kids figure shit out.
I'll tell you what. I'll tell you what. Right now, if you're a young, 20-year-old something, 20-something-year-old, the opportunities for you today are better. Better. Don't listen to the statistics where they say, "Oh, the workforce is harder and this and that and that." Bullshit. You have technology right fucking now where you can create your job tomorrow with less money than ever. Than ever. I have met, because of this podcast, I have met several self-made millionaires that did nothing but use YouTube, social media, Instagram, that kind of shit. And it cost them almost nothing to do. That did not exist 15 years ago.
The opportunity is insanely there.
If you have that fire inside of you, don't go get a job. Go make a job. Make that shit happen. It's right there for the taking right now.
I think the other hard challenge they have is learning to separate too, like their the things that they love to do and that's fun, that's their passion, versus the stuff that you need to do and you have to do, right? Like one of my favorite quotes is, we do the things that we have to do now so we can do the things we want to do later. And, there's no doubt. I know he's passionate about making videos, but I'll give you an example. So like we're sitting there having breakfast and I pull out my green juice from Organifi and I stir it up and like, he has no idea what that is. And I'm like, wait a second, you work for us. You don't know anything about Organifi. Like you need to understand that you may be really good about making these videos and making cool stuff, but you need to know anything and everything that we're into. And there's a ton of shit that you guys haven't been a part of for 2.5 years. You got to know the message that Mind Pump has been about for so long. You got to know what would it take for us to partner with a company like this, especially since
the decision making process to even get to that.
Right. We've been a company that's came out and bashed supplements for such a long time, and we have finally.
Like why are we working with this company?
Right. Then? And then how can you translate this into videos and make it entertaining for people while still staying true to our message and this is what we've had a hard time with. We've hired two different companies that do what he does. And we have not, and we've had to fire them because it's like they can't, they don't understand.
They go based off some old formula,
right? Well, they look at what is that Beachbody and like all these companies out there that are huge on the internet that are making millions of dollars, but it's hard when
their message is dinosaur,
right? Well, not as it dinosaur. It's actually, I mean, it's dinosaur is. I don't know if dinosaur is the right word because I feel like what they're doing is working, and many people that are modeling after that is working too.
Okay.
It's more
it's
like
current. Let's say it's not forward thinking.
It's the wrong mess. It's what's clickbaity, right? What is going to draw attention to then try and market and sell them.
The key is to understand those methods and utilize them with our message, which is one of integrity, which is one of real good fitness advice that helps people for reals, that isn't just bullshit, but is legit. That's what's sorely missing. And, we got to fight fire with fire. So we're going to use some of those techniques, but we're not going to sell bullshit. You know what I mean? I mean, that's one thing that we talked about from day one.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, I can't wait till we're doing what they're doing, but way better because of our message.
Well, and that's what I was trying to get across to him is like, I was like, you need to know this. Like, I can't hold your hand through this conversation. Like, you should be asking me, like, what was it that made us, partner with this company? Like, what did you guys like so much about them? And what are they doing so different that you said no to all these other companies, but all of a sudden that you're working with this company? Like, you need to be prompting those questions from me so that I can then give you those answers. And then you can think creatively to create these videos.
You know what? Let's give them some green juice. Give them the thing.
No, I did.
Have them use it.
I did. Yeah, okay. Because I was making it for myself. And so I let him taste it and stuff like that. And I told him, I was showing him what it was. And I flipped it around and was kind of teaching him everything.
I thought I'd never say this, but I actually enjoy using a green powder. I never thought I would say that.
Well,
I don't replace vegetables with it, by the way. I'm not in that camp, but I actually enjoy using it.
That's what I think someone asked, I've been getting actually a lot because I posted on my Insta story and they're like, oh, how often are you taking this? And it's like, well, I don't have I take this 4 times a week or I take this every day at this time. I evaluate my diet, right? So in a perfect world, I'm not taking this. Like in a perfect world, I am getting, 4 to 6 good sized servings of vegetables a day. But in reality, I fucking know I can't always do that, and so I'll look at like the previous day. If I go like, oh shit, I only got like 2 servings yesterday and I'm heading into this day and oh look, I already missed it in one meal already. I'm going to take that because I already know that I'm behind from the, that's how I use it. So sometimes in a week I could use it, you know, four times, maybe one time another week, and then maybe seven times another week. And when we're traveling and we're doing things, I'm not being able to get to my meals like I normally would. Well, so
yeah, I even drink a lot of water, and every now and then, like, you know, I get this sort of craving for some juice or you know, soda or something like that. So I've actually ended up like using the green juice like in replacement of that. So something like I would normally do, where I'm sort of, you know, I'm casual about it. I'm hanging out. And, you know, that's something that I can drink that's a little bit different.
No, that's smart. So I used to do this all the time when I was getting ready for shows and I was competing. And obviously, I can't have things that are, you know.
Oh, I could see a big, I could definitely see a benefit.
Oh, yeah, no, for sure. I mean, not only am I fueling my body with stuff that it needs and is good for, but it's also.
What is it, like 6 calories per serving?
Yeah, it's like,
it's,
and then if you blend it on ice, it's got a little. So, I mean, that's how you use it there, Justin. That's definitely how I use it during competing time, because this is how I get this, like, okay, satisfies this craving. And to be honest, to be totally transparent, like, I used to use a lot of times, like, BCAAs, some of that, which has got the bullshit flavoring and stuff like in there.
Just because you want that taste.
Yeah, just because I want some.
You still wanted the Diet Cokes every now and then, too, right?
Right.
Sometimes.
Right. Yeah. So, but this is a much better alternative to that, that's, you know, that doesn't have all that crap in it. So,
dude. So, you got it. So, Justin, I want you to tell. I want you to tell Adam that story that you told me out there.
You want me to tell it?
Dude.
It's we'll see.
I know you're tormented.
I'm a little tormented just because.
But it's life, dude. It's what you have to do.
It is life, dude. This is like, this was intense. This is an intense thing I had to go through. But
he had trouble telling me the story.
Well, only because.
Nah, I'm all ears.
Well, I didn't want to like come across certain ways. You know, on the podcast, we have to kind of think about things at a time, like what people's reaction may be to. You know, life.
We kind of do that.
You know what I mean? Like, kind of. Yeah, but I don't know.
Doug would probably disagree.
I'm totally okay with talking about stuff, and this is part of life, right? So, I haven't even brought up the chickens in a really long time.
Yeah, what's going on with them? Did you eat them?
No, listen.
Did you eat
Let me tell my damn story.
Okay, listen.
You know why I suck at telling stories? You guys fucking jack me every time.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah. So, basically, okay, like, I have how many now? I have probably, like, I have eight because we just added two.
Dang, you have a lot of chickens.
We got a lot. And we just got these two that 2 months ago, Courtney decided, we need, because they're not really producing. They're still having a really hard time producing eggs. And we were trying to figure it out.
Not making them feel comfortable, dude.
Dude, we ended up getting like two eggs for them to be moms and, you know, kind of deal with that whole thing that they had going on. And, you know, they grew up and now we have those other two, but there's still like this dysfunction amongst the group, right? And,
you took care of that.
yeah. Well, we'll get to all this. But basically, like, so there's one chicken that just dominates, right? and so there's like the two new ones are the sweetest little chickens like ever. Like, one of them comes up to me, I like pet it and stuff, and like my youngest son, he that's like his little buddy, you know. And it's the cutest little chicken. Anyways, all these other ones are assholes.
So they act like little dogs, the cute ones.
Yeah, the cute ones, little, you know, and we just introduced them to the group, and like it took them forever to accept them because they're assholes.
Right.
And
I didn't know chickens were such fuckers.
Oh, yeah, for
dude,
sure.
Dude, chicken fuckers.
Yeah, you gotta massage their feet, dude.
Massage their feet.
Yeah, that's how we get them to settle down and have more eggs. We used to do that all the time.
Wow. Are you serious?
I should consult you. Anyways. I should have consulted you. Anyway, basically, so there's this one fucking, this one chicken. That's
and it's a big one, right?
Big, the biggest of the big, right? And it eats all the food, pecks the fuck out of everybody else. Like, it almost left, like, one of the smaller ones, the sweet one, like, dead. Like, it just, like, pecked the hell out of it, ripped out all its feathers. And,
oh, fuck.
I mean, it was, like, I was like, oh, this asshole, you know? And, Courtney was just like, you know, at a loss, because in the mornings, every morning, it crows just like a rooster. It's just like super loud, obnoxious, 6 a.m. This has been happening for the last couple of weeks. And like, I know our neighbors do not like us. You know, this thing is just obnoxious. It's like just going after everybody. It's like hoarding all the food.
Bro, what did you do?
Just listen.
This is all part of the story. See how engaged he is, though? Yeah. So
he obviously had to practice this story like three times.
No, bro, I'm just getting better. So I take this chicken, right? It's the spotted chicken. I just have to be clear about all this stuff. I took her and I walked, you know, away from the coop, And I'm petting it nicely.
But you had to do research, right, to figure out how to.
I did have to do research. The climax is I had to take care of it, right? I had to take care of this problem. So, Courtney and I kind of decide. She actually was like thinking about it herself. She's like, "Oh my god, like this thing, it's taking over everything. Like we got to do something about it." She's like, "I just can't do it," and she just was all like distraught about it. And asked me to take care of it. And I was like, okay, you know, like this is something that I have to do. And so I went on YouTube. I'm looking up some different techniques, you know, the most humane, you know, or the most like the quickest way
to
do it.
What are you looking up for? What? What? Take care of what?
To kill it.
Oh, to kill it. To
kill it, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Shit. You didn't tell
Come
me
on,
that
bro.
You.
This is your friend. No,
he's speaking in fucking parables here. I can't put it together, man.
I didn't want you to yet. Oh, you killed it. Then it'd be the end of the story.
He's like the mafia. What happened to Johnny?
Yeah, yeah.
I took care of him.
Yeah, I took care of him.
I took care of him. Like, did you jerk it off? What do you do? I don't even know what you did over here. What's going on?
I mean, I definitely did something to its neck.
So you came over. You had to kill it.
Yeah, so I took it out, you know, away from the group, and I was like, you know, I want it, like, I love animals, dude, and so I'm just petting it, and I'm just like, you know, I want to make sure that it knows, like, I'm like, dude, you know, this has to happen, you know, like, yeah, I was petting it was looking at me a certain way, and so I grabbed it by the neck, and, you know, snap. I did this technique, and so, you know, I kind of swung it, and then, you know, snapped its neck, and, you know, and then it got crazy.
So, it's still alive for a minute.
So
what was it doing? Like fighting?
It'll run around like crazy.
Well, so its whole head kind of fell down, you know, it was like trying to kind of move and
PETA's coming out.
Yeah, and then I was put it down and try to let it all kind of resolve, and then it looked like it resolved, and I'm like, oh man, okay, and I went to go get it, you know, because, and then it the body like. Resurrected,
yeah.
And then it just, you know, jumped like and went right back towards the coop, and then like these other two chickens like came out of nowhere, like the younger ones, and they like it was in the corner, and I was kind of watching it. I was right next to the stair, and like these other two chickens came right over and started pecking the shit out of it, and like trying to like get into the action,
bro. They saw.
They were, like piranhas.
And these are the two that love Justin.
So. I can't believe you didn't consult me on any of this stuff. You know that this is what I did, bro.
I honestly, bro, I didn't even think about that.
Yeah. I would have walked you through exactly how to do all this. But what you should have done is you actually should have broke its neck in front of everybody else.
All the rest of them, so they knew?
You should have, yeah, set the precedence right there. Who's boss?
I thought about that.
Right there.
You I kind of had that as I was holding it in my arms and walking it away from them.
Just like
I kind of looked them all in the eyes like,
yeah,
just, listen, this is, you know, right? this is
why you're looking at all the rest of them.
It's kind of the reality.
But the crazy part to me is that the two little sweet chickens saw the big one that's fucking going down, and they're like, yeah!
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Almost as if they planned the whole thing. Like, they were sweet to Justin, his kids.
Wow, I didn't think of that.
They totally...
When was it?
You're making connections.
Was this just the other day?
This is yesterday.
Oh, this all happened to you yesterday.
So let me ask
last
you...
Last night.
So I know you're an animal lover, for sure.
Definitely.
And, you're not... Have you ever been hunting?
You know what? I've been hunting, but I haven't actually killed anything.
So you had to do this with your bare hands. Like,
yeah.
How do you do that? Like, what happens?
I had to really kind of summon this other operating system. I'm like, look, this just has to be done. Like, I have to do this in a certain way.
Did you feel like a caveman all
perform?
Of a sudden?
Yeah. So I just like, it brought back this real weird, like primal, like the button, you know what I mean? Like it just happened.
The first time you do that shit, it was
real.
It's very real. Most people have a hard time. I mean, I know I struggle with that stuff. I had to get used to it really quick. But
how do they kill chickens normally?
Oh, dude, we don't want to go down.
Yeah,
that's
not good.
I have some. I mean, when you get into some stories like that, we'll talk off air some of the shit that I had to do and go through, like it working on a ranch.
You know,
dude. There was some gruesome shit.
And your friend, you gave it to your friend, right?
Yeah, gave it to your friend. She's made a nice stew out of it.
Yeah. So the way I look at it is like, because I've never been hunting. I've never killed an animal before. I love animals, but I also eat animal. I eat meat all the time.
Right.
And I want to go hunting so bad, but it's not because I want to hunt. It's because I feel like a massive hypocrite because I eat meat, but I've never killed it before.
Yeah.
And so...
Well, that's what a lot of vegetarians will tell you. They'll say, like, you should go out and do that, and if you still feel fine and okay with
that's
it...
That's what I want to do.
That's where that was literally going through my head. Like, I felt, like, connected to, you know, because we had meat that night, too, and I'm just like, okay, you know, like, this is, like... The reality of what it takes, you know, to produce your food and on my table, like I have to know, you know, I got to be a part of that. And I still felt like this is life. Like this life takes life to survive. So, you know, this is one of those things.
I didn't eat chicken for a couple of weeks after the first experience for me.
Really?
But mine was really gruesome compared to that.
Oh, yeah.
So
I didn't want to cut its neck.
We raised them. Killed them, plucked them,
yeah.
Boiled them, did all that. Like I did, like from start to finish, like every process of that, right? And the first time we had to do that, it was like just because
if it was one of the sweeter ones, I had a real hard.
Well,
time
and I spent hours of doing that one day. You know, what I'm saying, like my first day of doing that was like all day. All I'm doing is slitting throats and like to working with them for like 4 hours, and then like later that night, like chicken didn't sound very good that day.
Well,
so it took me about a week or so before.
This part of us as humans that we are completely disconnected from. I mean, the only time you see meat in modern societies is at the grocery store, and it's covered in plastic in a container, and it's a cut of meat. Like you don't realize. And so I've had this thought so many times because I do have a lot of empathies for vegans who do it for moral reasons. I've said it so many times on the podcast, and part of me is like, look, I need to go kill an animal and eat what I kill. Otherwise, I feel like a massive hypocrite because one of two things is going to happen. I'm going to kill the animal and then become a vegan because if I have a big problem with it, that's what I'm going to do. Or I kill it, realize what's going on, and don't become a vegan. But
I could see you going that direction.
Yeah. What?
Going vegan?
You think
of that.
So?
Yeah. Well, out of the three of us in this room, I think you're the most likely to do that.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Who knows? I don't know because I've never done it. The closest I've ever come was when I went to Sicily as a 12 years old, and we went to my cousin had just eloped with this dude who was from like the hills of Sicily, so they're like old school Sicilian. Like you drive up, and they've got you know suspenders on and a rifle, and they've got animals, and you know like. Old school Sicilian people. And we walk into this barn where we were all going to have this big dinner later on that night. And I'm 12, so I have no idea what the fuck's going on. And there's this like little like lamb, you know, tied up in the corner.
Mm.
So I'm like, oh, they have a pet. It's so cute. So I played with the lamb. I'm over there playing with it and, you know, doing the whole thing. And fuck, dude, next thing I know, like 2 hours later, here comes my uncle and my dad and all these guys, and they've got the knife and they're like, hey, you want to watch us kill the, you know, this is what we're going to have tonight for dinner. And I'm like, oh, fuck. Like,
wow.
But I'm 12, and you know, at 12 as a boy, you're trying to become a man, right? So if I was like 10, I would have been like, no, and I would have ran away. But I'm 12, so I'm like, okay, I have to stay here and watch this whole thing.
Yeah.
And I did, and I watched the whole thing, and it disturbed me, but then I ate the meat, and I was okay. So I think I'll be okay hunting, too.
Yeah.
You know
I told you guys for my best friend who got married just as last... This was last year, the year before, right? I had to go... That was part of my duties as a best man. Him and I had to go slaughter a pig.
What?
Yeah, dude.
What kind of a wedding?
Yeah, that's a lot more involved.
Yeah, it's a mong. That's part of the tradition.
Oh, yeah.
And then from that, you literally slaughter it, and then we go and clean it all, like all the brothers and all the family get together, and that's all part of the wedding process.
You got it.
And yeah.
Oh, my god.
And then you prepare it, and then for the wedding dinner and everything like that, that's part of the wedding dinner. That's
See, crazy. I've gutted animals before. Like, my grandpa, like, would put up a deer, and, you know, I'd help him, like, clean it out and all that stuff, and I've done that with fish, like, countless times. This is the first time, you know, like, with,
well,
with
hey.
A live animal where I'm just like, okay.
Well, yeah, when you take the life like that and that close with your bare hands, it's a different
thing. It's a part of us, it's even different.
Because I've done all of it, right? So not all of it, but I've done a lot of that. Right, growing up on a farm, been around a lot of like stuff with that, and I've even hunted. And there's a difference in shooting something from a distance and it falling down, and then you dragging it home, and then having to do stuff versus you with your bare hands having to take the
up close and personal. I'm wondering why the bird's not coming.
save us.
Yeah. Hey, listen, bird, you're cool. Yeah. Just be cool, right?
This Quah is brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
All right, our first question is from Jacob Emery 24. You mentioned protein cycling and cycling other supplements such as creatine. How often and how long should you cycle these and other supplements?
That's a great question. I don't think there's a good specific answer. Yeah. I really don't.
Well,
tell you what I do. You know, with protein cycling, I have anywhere between 2 to maybe 6 days out of the month. So either once a week, once or twice a week, or sometimes once every other week. Okay, so it depends on what's happening with my life at the time. But I will have a low protein day or even just a low calorie day. In fact, when me and Adam were in LA, I don't think I ate more than 1,200 calories each day. We ate almost, we barely ever ate. And when I do that, I actually feel phenomenal. Not during, while I'm doing it during, I don't really necessarily notice anything. But when I come back and then eat normally, I seem to get this boost that I wouldn't have gotten had I not done that in terms of performance or whatever. And so that's one of the reasons why I do it. The other reason why I do it is going low on protein or fasting where you don't have any protein. That's one of the reasons why you accelerate or promote apoptosis of cells, which is the program cell death. So it's the lack of carbohydrates and the lack of protein that actually promote that. Now, fat will inhibit some of it, but you can have just fat and low calories and not have protein or carbohydrates, and you'll still do this. In fact, Dr. Walter Longo, his fasting mimicking diet is similar to that. I know I'm butchering it, but it's similar to what I'm talking about. As far as creatine is concerned, I used to take creatine every day in and day out.
For years, you said, right?
Since I was 16.
Whoa, wow, consistent with
that. So I've been taking creatine for a very, very long time. Luckily, it's been proven to be safe.
Oh, man.
I know that would suck if some shit came out.
Yeah.
But I do take, I only take creatine on my hard workout days now. So now I take it probably 3 days a week. And that's pretty much it. So I guess that counts as cycling. I should probably go completely off for a couple weeks, but I think it's a good idea to do all supplements that way. And the way I judge it with supplements, because there are some supplements that I'll take that I notice somewhat of a benefit, is I'll take them until I notice I don't get that benefit that much anymore. And then rather than taking more, I stop. So coffee is an example. Caffeine, I get a great benefit from it. I feel great. I feel motivated. I get lots of ideas. I'm on fire. When I start to notice that I drink the caffeine and don't get really that much of it, and it just kind of makes me feel normal, that's when I start to cycle out of it and then kind of repeat the cycle. So,
well, I like that you said that, because you're right. I think it's almost impossible to give like a protocol for this because of the individual variance of not only the individual variance of everybody's body types and genetic makeup, but even their routines and their habits and the foods that they naturally gravitate would completely change how I would recommend this. For example, when we talk about creatine, not that long ago, I just started. It was maybe 2-3 weeks ago now, or I don't know when this comes out. So it's only been a small while that I've been taking creatine again. And part of the only reasons why I did that, one, it's been a long time since I've taken creatine, and I've been meaning to get around to, like, oh, let's see if I throw it in and see if I notice a little a difference, right? The other reason that really sparked me to do it was that I had reduced my red meat intake significantly. And that's the main source that where we can find creatine in naturally, right? So when you eat a steak, you get some creatine in there. And it's not quite the amount that you would get in a supplement serving. But if you're somebody like me who eats red meat a lot, I'm getting quite a bit of natural creatine in my diet. And because I haven't been eating nearly as much, I thought, okay, well, this will be a good time to do it. Because if I ever was going to see a boost from supplementing for it, it would be when I'm lacking it in my diet. So, and the same thing would go true for things like protein. Like the people that I think, in my opinion, are going to benefit the most from cycling off protein or having a protein-free day like Sal does are the people that overconsume it. So if you're somebody who consumes 200 grams, 300 grams of protein pretty consistently, those guys and girls are going to see probably the most benefit from cycling off of it once or every other week, where you have a day where you pretty much don't have any or have very, very minimal. So that's how I would recommend if you're somebody who is oversaturating yourself with, you know, a protein, I would cycle off of it pretty frequently. Like if you're a high protein intake person, 200 grams plus for a normal body weight, I would be telling you, okay, once a week, kind of like what Ben Pokolsky recommends.
That's what he said, right? Once a week. Yeah. That was the goal that I used to aim for.
Yeah. But I also think if you're someone like me, where right now I'm struggling to hit my protein targets, you know, I think it's, although I still think it's beneficial, I think it's less beneficial for me who's already struggling to get enough protein in on a regular basis than the guy or girl who is over consuming a lot. So just keep that in mind.
Did you notice anything, by the way, from the creatine? Because you said you hadn't taken it for a while.
I am digging it right now. I'm feeling good. My workouts...
Stronger, right?
Yeah, stronger and going longer. You know, my stamina in my workouts, that's really what it does, right? I mean, we're replenishing our...
Stronger and going longer.
Yeah.
That's the great best tagline.
That's the best creatine commercial of all time.
Yeah. You know, I was gravitating to that.
It's one of the few supplements you can take and notice. You know what I mean? Where you take it and within 5 days you're like, oh shit, I can tell.
Oh, so, yeah, I know.
Because we're not sponsored by a creatine company and Organifi doesn't supply creatine, I had to go buy it, right? I asked the guy, I'm like, hey, I want to get creatine. I just want the pill form. Which ones you got? And he's like, oh, we got these right here. He's like, take that one.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, what's
that? Creed 5000.
Why is this one? He's like, well, that one has creatine and ATP.
And I'm like boom.
Huh? I was like so confused.
Mic drop.
I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, yeah, no, you got to get that one. That's the newest one that has creatine and ATP. And I'm like, okay, that doesn't make sense to me. That fucking creatine is what's getting converted over into ATP. I'm like, I understand how you're putting that in powdered form for me to consume. And I tried to get him to explain it to me, and I was just like, never mind. I'll go home.
You know what's funny about that?
I'll go home and look it up myself.
That's not the way it works. So, yeah, you can buy adenosine triphosphate.
But your body's not, you
destroy it. It doesn't do anything. It's like
leptin. It's like when people take leptin, the same thing.
Yeah, it doesn't work. It's like, here's a good example.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to boost nitric oxide, okay, arginine is one, basically the closest step to converting to nitric oxide. However, citrulline, which gets converted to arginine, which then gets converted to nitric oxide, does a much better job of boosting nitric oxide than arginine does, even though it's an extra step. And that's because it doesn't get destroyed by the body like arginine does. So yeah, I love seeing these supplements like pure ATP. It's like, man, why would I even take creatine then? I'll just take that shit and just be like,
well, that's why I was so confused. But I'm like, this is hilarious that they're now doing this with creatine. I didn't even know that this was a thing until I hadn't bought creatine in a long time.
It has molecules.
And I'm like, right.
That's kind of like
powerful. He's like telling me, and I'm like, oh, I shouldn't have asked. Why did I do that?
That's literally what they say, right?
Yeah. Totally.
Why should I take this creatine? Yeah. Oh, It's got enzymes.
It's a chemical explosion.
No. Electrolytes. Yeah. That's the one that we remember, guys.
Yeah. It's the catalyst for stimulation.
It catalyzes anabolism.
You know, a little bit of an off topic, but it is along these lines. I mean, this is what the industry does, is we take a little bit of information that we know is true. We know that creatine helps replenish, right, your ATP, ADP molecules, right? Yeah. So with that, what if we put ATP in with the creatine? Boom! You know, and so
anybody's thought of the combo.
Right. So then if somebody who is a, like, you know, average consumer who may have read a couple magazine articles or a study, you might look at that and go like, oh shit, this shit's on your regular creatine because I'm getting the ATP with my creatine. My
yeah.
So
some of the supplements out there crack me up, like deer antler velvet. Like how are they harvesting this?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Nobody thinks about that.
There's like a whole bunch of like deer, and there's people like just picking off the the velvet.
Yeah. Well, still. I mean,
what is it?
Or the white tree bark that's blessed by monks that you always say?
Yeah. Or, you know,
don't they put some kind of like like urine, you know, like for like testosterone.
There is some, a like, product. There that, is like, a urine one.
Right?
What is that?
I have no idea.
Bullfrog urine.
Oh my god!
It has to be some weird, right?
It does.
Then people will buy it.
Yeah.
People won't buy it if it's like.
Yeah. If I said, "Hey, I pissed in this. This is gonna help you."
It can't be like. It's not gonna be.
I'm on testosterone. If you drink this, you're gonna get results.
It can't be like golden retriever urine. We'd be like, that's not that exotic,
right?
You know, but like, African frog snake piss or some weird shit like that. Like, oh my god,
wow!
I've never heard of an African
frog
snake.
That's like from ancient Greece.
That's crazy. Yeah. You guys know
mythical creature.
You guys know horny goat weed, right? The supplement. So horny goat weed actually has something in it that does prevent the enzyme that degrades nitric oxide from doing what it does. So you do get better boners with horny goat weed. Do you guys know why it's named horny goat weed?
No.
Well, I'm sure the goats were banging stuff, right?
Yeah. So, like herders. Notice, this is the legend. Oh, notice that their goats were just fucking raging like crazy.
Yeah,
and they deduced that it's because they're eating these things. So then they picked them, and then they made their own teas and whatever. This is a long time. It's an old supplement.
Oh my god!
And is that an old wives' tale too?
Or no, crazy goats.
Does it have some validity to it?
No, that's literally why it's called horny goat weed.
Wow.
You know what I mean? Mm. It's cool because it's got my three favorite things.
There you go, ladies and gentlemen. There's your knowledge bomb of the day. Moving along, Douglas.
Quick commercial break. Hey, people ask us all the time how they can support Mind Pump. Here's what you can do. You can go to www.brain.fm/mindpump and get 20% off Brain FM for meditation or focus. You can also go to audibletrial.com/mindpump and get a 30-day trial plus one free audio book. Lastly, you can go to getnatureblend.com/mindpump and you will get a discount on Ben Greenfield's CBD product.
Bronc Rider 3445 can't eat vegetables. The thought of putting something green in his mouth repulses him, both the taste and the texture.
Hold on. How old is this guy?
Stop.
Keep going.
He's like...
Yeah. So putting something on them or cooking them just doesn't do it. The only way is to blend with a bunch of fruit and almond milk. Is this a sustainable way to get nutrition, or is he missing out on blending?
You want it in a sippy cup?
Yeah, Justin. You know what I mean?
You're a dick.
You know what?
This is actually more common than you would think,
But you know what pisses me off about this question?
What?
I'll tell you what pisses me off.
Why?
Vegetables is a big category. So, like, can't eat vegetables. He's made up his mind. I'm not going to eat vegetables. Like, that's the number one thing. But let's just say you do genuinely, you don't have an allergy to them, and you don't have some psychological blockage. Because that could be very true, too. Like, you could psychologically be so repulsed that
I'm going to go down that direction. So if you finish your statement here, because I'm going to defend this poor guy after you guys mutilate him.
So no, I'm not going to mutilate him. So I have a story that is kind of related to this that I've experienced recently. So I don't make any. It's not a mystery that I don't like the taste of alcohol. I just simply don't. I don't enjoy alcohol at all. If I do drink, it's because I plan on getting buzzed or drunk, so it's not like I'm enjoying the alcohol. And if I want to enjoy the taste of alcohol, it's usually mixed with some kind of
something
colorful,
really fruity
something. Yeah, I'm going to get something that that Adam and Justin are going to make fun of me over, which has always happened.
We would never do that.
This whole time, like, my I'm Italian. My family, they love wine. And, you know, my ex-wife's family used to drink wine all the time. And, you know, my girlfriend, she enjoys whiskey, believe it or not. And sometimes she likes red wine. And so she's telling me, like, we're having this conversation. I'm like, I just don't like the fucking taste. Like, I don't like the taste. And she's like, you have to be mindful of it. You have to smell it and start to appreciate the flavor. Not necessarily like the flavor, but just appreciate and really be mindful of it. So I actually have been having a shot glass worth of wine every night for the past maybe 3 nights. Just a shot glass worth, because I'm not trying to drink a lot of alcohol, but because I'm trying to do this, and I'm approaching it with the mentality of I want to see where I can take my mind with this. Not necessarily because I want to drink wine, but because a lot of people like wine. There's a reason why a lot of people like wine, right? So let me see what I can do with this. So she pours me just a shot glass worth, and it takes me, no joke, we'll sit outside for an hour and a half and we'll have conversation. That's how long it takes me to drink this. Because what I do is I smell it. I stick my nose in the glass and I smell it and smell it and smell it. Then I taste a tiny bit, let it sit in my mouth. And I'm really trying to understand the flavor and appreciate it. And something interesting happened. Something snapped after like the second or third night. I recognized, like, it reminded me a little bit of vinegar. And I don't mean because it's bad wine. But, you know, if you leave wine out too long, it does turn into that, right? Mm. And there's something...
Yeah. That's somebody who's a big wine connoisseur is listening right now. They're like, bro, you're drinking shit wine.
No. What I mean is, it's like, I don't know. I could kind of understand now why people appreciate it a little bit. And I do like
things
that...
Well, you drink kombucha, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I'm realizing that part of the reason why I don't like wine isn't because I don't like wine necessarily. It's because I decided I didn't like wine. Right. A long time ago when I was a kid.
You put that in your head. And
totally.
It's always been your go-to.
Totally.
Yep.
And so now, believe it or not, I'm starting to appreciate a little bit. And I think if I keep up with it, I'll probably start to enjoy the taste. Yeah. Now, my girlfriend has had a similar experience with vegetables. She grew up in a family that ate no vegetables ever. She never ate vegetables at all until her 20s. And she said she did the same thing where just the smell of vegetables or the sight of it made her gag. But then she started really getting into health and wellness. So she started doing what I did with the wine. And she said after doing that, after a few months, there were certain vegetables that she started to enjoy eating. And now me and her, like, vegetables is one of our favorite parts of our meals. Now, I grew up with vegetables, so it's not a big deal. But she is a huge vegetable lover. Well, she'll eat it and enjoy the taste. So that would be some advice I'd give you in terms of, you know, trying to eat them.
Oh, well, before you go, the reason why I'm so hard on him is because of the fact that, you know, as I was raised, that was like I hated them. I hated vegetables because of it. And I figured out once I moved out of the house, or not even moved out of the house, I think once I, you know, was like in junior high or high school, it's like I started to go out and go to my friends' houses and taste, you know, how they prepared them. And that was like game changer. It was like, it was getting microwaved, you know, it was like butter all over it. So the go-to for like my parents was like, you will eat this, and so we'll make it more tasty by putting like Velveeta cheese on it and like, you know, like butter and like all these things. And they made it more soggy, more disgusting. And it just like, it was terrible. So, you know, when I actually had a little bit of like a crunch to it and, you know, was able to really kind of taste how it should taste with like light, you know, oil on it, or like it had some garlic, or it had, you know, something that, you know, all in the preparation of it, it changed everything. So,
well, I had a similar relationship with them as Jessica did. And that's where I was going to defend this guy or girl, whoever, I don't know if it's a guy or girl, defend them about this, is because, you know, I struggled with this for a long time, and there was a couple reasons. And I find it most common that when I have clients that struggle with eating vegetables share this similar story. Now, there's exceptions to the rule, but for the most part, most people that can't stand them, hate them, all this stuff, like kind of where Sal was going, is at some point in your life, like, you've established this, you know, and more often than not, it's when you were a child, and either one, you had a parent that forced it down your throat, and so there is this like resentment that you have to it, you know, like when your parents tell you have to do something, you really don't want to do it just because you're being told to, so you've built this relationship with it because you had to, now you don't want to. Or you grew up in a home like mine where my parents not only didn't make us have vegetables, we rarely even had them around. And so I ate sugar and crap and all kinds of bad food. And so I never even created a palate for that. And I was eating all these foods that were artificially enhanced that caused my palate to be off. So then when I go to try and eat vegetables, they're bland and boring as fuck and just taste like I'm eating grass. And then I get older and I get a little bit wiser and realize, okay, vegetables are important. I need to make sure I have them. But now I'm like in my early 20s and I'm a trainer now. And I know I need to somewhat have them. But then I would eat them, but it would be like forcing them down because I'm eating them because I know I need them, but I can't enjoy them because at that time in my life, I was still suffering from the you know, demonizing of fat. And so I didn't use olive oil or salts or butter or things that can make a freaking vegetable really, really fucking good when you learn and learn to cook with these things. So I was eating just plain ass broccoli, asparagus, green beans. I mean, just boiled or steamed with nothing on them. So, you know, talk about a guy who already doesn't have a palate for it, and their palate's all fucked up because of all the crap I used to consume. Then I go to eat vegetables. Then when I'm eating the vegetables, I'm steaming or boiling them only. So I was like, this is just rough for me. Now, it wasn't until later on that I really start to enjoy them when I started to season them and I used salts and butters and oils and balsamic and actually could learn to prepare them a little better. And it was like, oh, shit, okay, these could be a little more palatable. That really changed the game for me. But I will say this. You don't want to beat up on yourself if this is one of the ways that you get your supplements. I think that's totally okay if you blend them up. I think we're trying to address this relationship that you have with it and talk about, you're not losing by blending it up. You're not, I mean, if you are juicing it, different story, but if you're blending it, you're getting a lot of the benefits from it. And this is also why I highly recommend the green juice with that we use from Organifi. If you're somebody who doesn't consistently like me, because even though I've learned to like them more, I eat them more often, there still are days where I could go all day long and not really get any vegetables in. And so when I do that, then it becomes important that I include something like this into my diet because I'm already somebody who has to actively think about including. I'm not like Sal, out of all of us, is the best at this. Like this guy will literally come in with, you know, 4 cups of broccoli and he'll sit down and eat just broccoli
like
by
a mountain.
Yeah. And I've tried to, since being around him, that's something that I've taken and I've tried to do, and I've definitely gotten better with it. I definitely can do that now. I've learned, and Doug made this incredible dish for us one of the first times we traveled.
Oh, that's right.
Oh, with the Brussels sprouts?
Yeah, Brussels sprouts.
Yeah, that was good.
And walnuts and bacon.
That's all we ate that night.
And balsamic and then ghee butter over it. And I've shared this recipe on my Instagram before. Like, man, that was I literally now will sit down and just eat a whole bowl of Brussels sprouts because
it
actually tastes phenomenal. So, you know, between trying to put that in and practice it, using different things to prepare it, look up recipes. If you're just boiling or steaming it, man, that shit can get boring real fast, especially with somebody that's already struggling psychologically with them and doesn't enjoy the taste.
Well, there was a second part, too, about blending them, if he's missing out because he's blending them.
No, I addressed that.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty much okay, but also keep this in mind. And I'm learning more and more about the importance of this. Chewing your food.
That's part of the digestion.
It is. Yeah. It not only is chewing your food part of the digestion. So I used to think chewing the food is part of the digestion because it's just my teeth.
You're breaking it down.
No.
Like that's what you're thinking.
It's also the saliva.
Yeah, for sure.
Your saliva mixes in there. And while you're chewing things, your stomach is producing things. So it's actually a big part of it. So yeah, you can totally blend them. It's totally fine. That's a great way to get them if you hate them, absolutely hate them. But chewing and eating things is the best way.
I mean, is it hard for you not to feel like a parent right now, though? Just chew your food and eat your greens. Okay? Do it.
All right. Next up, Nick Ford Health. On the days he uses the sauna after training, should he do his post-prime directly after his workout or after his sauna?
This is a good question.
I'm wondering if he's wanting to know Prime Pro or MAPS Prime, because if he's priming his body for his workout.
Well, it's the post prime, meaning that, so in MAPS
his
Prime.
His fortification sessions.
Yeah, so in
okay,
MAPS.
That's why I'm saying.
Yeah, so MAPS Prime, so it's Prime and Prime Pro. MAPS Prime teaches your body, this is for the listeners who don't have the program, it shows you how to design your priming sessions, which is a far, far better thing than a warm-up because it sets your body up. Yeah. So it sets what you do before.
Throw
but it also
away your pre-workouts and do this instead.
Right. So, but it also shows, we don't talk about this much on the show, it also teaches you what you should do immediately after your workout with what we call a post-prime session. The post-prime session's job, okay, so the pre-prime session's job is to set your body up for what you're about to do by giving you a better chance to have better recruitment patterns based on your body.
Yeah, you're teaching your body these movements going into the workout.
Yes,
yeah.
After the workout, the post-prime session is designed to solidify whatever signal that you've sent with your workout. So that's an important thing to understand because the closer it is to after your workout, the better. But here's a second reason why you shouldn't do it after a sauna and why you shouldn't do any kind of hard training or correctional, anything right after a hot sauna. Heat does depress the central nervous system. That's why when you get really tired, you get lazy and lethargic. It's just part of what heat does. It's part of the benefit of what heat provides. But if you're right after your sauna session, you're number one, you're far away from your workout or further away from your workout, so it loses some of its potency. But also, you're all hot. Your CNS is kind of down-regulated a little bit, and everything feels a little... Now you're going to go try doing this post-prime session, which is supposed to take advantage of the CNS that you just amped up with your workout.
Right.
That is no longer there, so there's actually a big difference. You're far better off doing your post-prime session right after your workout and then do the sauna afterwards, but not doing the sauna in between.
Quick commercial break, you guys. We keep getting asked all the time, how can I support the Mind Pump family? Here's one of the best ways you guys can. You guys love that Chimera coffee that we have. Chimera coffee with a K. You go to chimeracoffee.com, put in the discount code MINDPUMP for 10% at the checkout. Also, you guys have not tried Ben Greenfield's new bars out. They're fantastic. If you want some, go to bengreenfieldfitness.com/naturebite. Put in the code MINDPUMP and get 10% off. Go check it out.
DJ Pellet 85, or maybe Pele. Thoughts on sandbag?
DJ, so DJ Pele 85. Pele, la, la, la.
Thoughts of sandbag training for both muscular development and fat burning?
You fucking sandbagger.
Whoa, that almost sounded racist.
Remember when we used to say sandbaggers? Huh? Do you remember that?
Sound? Oh, at 24.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Somebody who used to hold revenue for the next month.
You know what they
would
do?
You're a sandbagger.
You know what they would do, Doug? Because Doug's looking at us. So at 24 Fitness, we would have these closeouts. Okay.
Oh, yeah. They wait months.
There was an end of month closeout, which is when you ended all the monthly promotions. And then there was a mid month closeout, which is when you ended some shorter promotions. And the goal was to have like these massive sales days, right?
Yeah.
So what idiots would do, and I call them idiots because I used to look at this.
Why
and be
would
like,
you
this
not
makes
close
no,
somebody right away and hold
no,
on to it?
It makes no fucking sense.
Well, there's other things, and Sal,
they're motivated to win.
Sal can experience. Justin, this was long gone by the time Justin came in, but I remember this. Do you remember way back in the days when we actually could control when the credit card actually was charged?
Oh my
no
god!
So,
way.
So a strategy oh, that wow. some would do would be this. So let's say. I max out my paycheck. So like back then we used to get paid by percentage of override. So if you hit 110% of goal or whatever back then, you made X amount
so,
of dollars.
So this is so against so, company yeah, company
this,
rules.
This is super illegal, right?
You're gonna get fired.
So and let's say
you never did this.
Let's say I sold you know, I hit it's a day before the end of the month and I hit my max goal. So I'm maxing out my
paycheck.
So you're
not gonna make any more money.
I'm not gonna make any more money, but the club still technically has about another $10,000 in revenue that people's credit cards are supposed to get ran that day. So what you would do is you would not run those credit cards that day. You would wait till the first of the month the next day, and then you would run the $10,000 through to start the next month off really good, so you're off and running. So
and that's sandbagging.
That's real sandbagging.
Okay, so. All right. So, that is dirty.
Yeah, horrible.
So, yeah. Dirty.
There's worse stuff, but okay, so
yeah, we'll stop with that.
Yeah, well, if we ever want a job back with anyway.
Yeah, we don't. So,
sandbag training for muscular development and fat burning is excellent. One of the reasons why sandbag training is so awesome is because it is an awkward tool to hold. It's you can do things with sandbags that you can't do with weights and that you can't do with other tools by just because of the nature of the sandbag itself. If you're an athlete, it's extremely valuable. If you're a grappler, a lot of your workout should be done with a sandbag. If you got big sandbags that you could throw and lift and run with and put up on your shoulder to
think about lifting somebody up, right?
Exactly.
Like how awkward that is. So it's very applicable to those types of sports and those interactions, you know, because yeah, the sandbag does provide that sort of like that weight that shifts on you and you have to adjust and you have to be able to move your body accordingly. And so it's nice for training when you know, you're in those types of sports for sure.
You have a lot of experience training with sandbags,
I do,
right?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. But what are some good, like, great exercises?
I mean, I do some cleans with them, which I always like to do. I do some lunge walks where I have it like loaded on one side specifically, or you know, I'm front loaded and I'm carrying it. Just to accommodate for the weight. Cause a lot of times when I go to tackle, you know, like, and they're still trying to drive forward, like, you know, I would have to turn and I have to keep driving. And while their weight was shifting, I had to accommodate for that. So it was very applicable for football too. Mm. So.
I think that it, you know, since you guys said all the good things about it, I think here it's not the best thing for building muscle or
it's
best
like
thing.
An accessory,
right? It's something that I think
for aesthetics I don't know, it would be hot,
right?
Yeah.
And so it is not like anything else. I don't think that there's one thing that's the best for this or best for that. Where I see it I think the person that should use it is if you're like you, these guys just named, a wrestler, a football player. It has way more carryover to what they're doing. Now, it does, I think, for functional training. Like, so if you're someone who's more driven functionally, which is not muscle development or fat burning, you just want to be a functional person. You don't give a shit about how lean and ripped you are and how big your muscles are.
I'm not thinking about fat burning throwing a sandbag around.
Well, that's exactly. And that's the question. The question is, you know, both muscular development and fat burning. And I would say, no, it's not. It's not that great for it in comparison to a bunch of other stuff that you should probably be doing inside the gym with barbells and dumbbells. Mm-hmm. But I do think, like the guys were just saying, it's an incredible tool. It's an awesome tool that can be utilized with lots of different benefits, like the guys were just saying. I also think that it's probably one of the more functional types of things that you can do in the gym, because let's be honest, in real life, like, you know, how many times have you thrown a bag of dog food over your shoulder and carried it? How many times have you grabbed a 5-gallon bucket of water and carried it on one side?
How much was that, 200 pounds, that one that you picked up?
Yeah.
That's a great point that you said that, Justin, because so they, at the Golds you work out at, the, right, they have this big 200-pound sandbag.
Right.
And from a muscular development perspective, and this is, by the way, this is not for the beginners or intermediate. This is if you're advanced. So if you're at the level like Adam, where he's been training a long time, he understands his body, and he's developed quite a bit of muscle already, and he's trying to figure out different ways to hit muscles differently and to target small areas. A sandbag can be amazing in one respect in particular, rounded back lifting.
Yep.
We don't talk about rounded back lifting. Now, rounded back lifting doesn't mean that my lower back is all rounded and I look like a dog taking a shit. That's not what I'm talking about. What I mean is, when you're doing a lift or a deadlift or a row, whatever, very rarely are you lifting with a lot of intensity where your scapula is spread out.
It's usually hugging.
It's, yeah. So with the sandbag, you got to lean over.
Which in real life is actually more
very common.
Oh, right. That's how you lift things.
Yeah.
You lift things with the scapula. I mean, you go grab a couch or whatever. You're not sitting there with a super ridiculous posture. You got to kind of reach around it and kind of hug it. And so when you're lifting a heavy sandbag off the floor with this rounded upper back position where your scapula spread, you will develop those muscles in different ways, differently than you would with other traditional, you know, barbell lifts.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, you know, for Adam, I mean, you did that for a second, right?
Mm-hmm.
And how did you notice? What did you notice in your back?
I overdid it. Remember, I don't know if you guys remember, I did talk about it briefly on the show. I mean, that was, somebody had posted, first of all, picking it up, there's probably only, I don't know, maybe 10, 20 people in our gym that could even do that. A 200-pound sandbag is no joke.
And like, I was only Jerry,
right?
You, huh?
Yeah, I was lifting it up over 5 feet too. So I was lifting it up and then setting it up on a platform up about 5 feet, maybe a little bit higher. So that's pretty fucking brutal. I mean, it's brutal to do one of those. I was trying to get 10 out for time, and I think I ended up doing 15 of them, just practicing the mechanics of it. And boy, was I freaking sore. I mean, I was sore everywhere from my low back to my hamstrings. My glutes got sore from it. My biceps, having to wrap my arms around that.
Oh, another good point.
Oh, God. My biceps felt like I had one of the hardest bicep workouts I'd done in a long time. I mean, it got me. I overdid it for sure. I mean, I should have not. I mean.
But it's interesting because you could have done the same volume, the same intensity with other exercises that you're used to, and you wouldn't have been hammered. Like
right,
that.
Right. No, I mean, that definitely is an example of, you know, how unique and different it is in comparison to normal barbell, dumbbell movements. And then to go do something like that, it is that different from normal lifting that it got me really good. And it, of course, pushing at that level, that's not smart. That's not the smart trainer in me. I would never allow a client to have not done any real sandbag work or stone work really ever, you know, but I'm a strong guy who's aware of mechanics, and I have pretty good proprioception. So I feel confident that I could pretty much look at almost any movement and exercise and perform it. I would hope I can. And so I, instead of like working my way up to that, like I should have, you know, maybe do a 50-pound bag, then a 100-pound bag, then a 150-pound bag, and then eventually get to 200, I went and grabbed the 200-pound bag, which some guys can't even get off the damn floor, and I did it. And that, you know, I paid for it for sure.
I'd like to get a sandbag in here. I think it'd be good. We could show people how to use it.
Yeah, no, I actually.
That would be a nice YouTube series.
You know, it is. And it's actually not that expensive to do. And if, since we just brought it up right now, if you remind me when we get out of here, I'll order one because I wanted to do that already. So I'd love to get like from 50 to a 200, so 50, 100, 150, one, and then 200,
and then we've got the big steps so we can even emulate kind of what you did with
that. Absolutely
excellent. With that, we just talked about YouTube. We have a YouTube channel. We post a new video on it every single day, 365 days a year, 366 days on leap year.
Whoa.
Yeah, so basically every day, it's Mind Pump TV. Go check it out. Hit subscribe. We love you. Also, if you want to ask us a question that we answer on an episode like this one, the place to do it is Instagram. The page to do it on is Mind Pump Media. Now, I have a personal page. It's Mind Pump Sal. Justin is Mind Pump Justin. And Adam is Mind Pump Adam.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.